Microsoft works with customers across the world. And in the past, some customers chose their cloud providers by looking at their competitors so they didn't end up on the same cloud. I mean, think about it. If you've used Azure for any length of time, you should know that our subscriptions are boundaries, and our networks are also boundaries. But the underlying physical hardware that all of these things are running on do exist in a physical location, in a physical data center somewhere in the world. So when you run your VM, you are isolated and separated from all of the other people running VMs on that same host across multiple different subscriptions. But sometimes for customers, that's not enough. There may be regulatory or security reasons why they need an extra layer of separation. But Microsoft wants Azure to be the cloud for everyone, so it's been built from the ground up to provide a lot of separation, but still have everybody running on the same regions, in the same availability zones, in the same data centers, on the same racks, and sometimes on the same hosts as others. So we've got to still be able to do that while giving the option to somehow be separate from everyone at the same time. That sounds like a really hard problem to solve. But Microsoft has done the hard work to make it easy for you. And we're going to talk about how you can take advantage of it today with Azure Dedicated Hosts. I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy. The story of dedicated hosts is really a straightforward one. We want to take a physical host running in Azure, assign it to a particular customer's Azure subscription so that no other systems are going to run on that host. That way we isolate the compute and the memory of that host to one customer, and that way we provide an area of isolation and security. And here's the main page for our docs. This is docs.microsoft.com, and a short link to get there would be aka.ms/Azure docs. When you get here, you go to products, and then we can go to either Linux or Windows virtual machines. And in the table of contents link, we want to go under the concepts, and under there, go to dedicated hosts. So basically what we're going to do is create a host group, and inside that host group, which is a Azure resource construct, we're going to create a dedicated host, which will then select a host out of the particular availability zone, fault domain, all in the region that we want, and take that host and assign it to our subscription, which then we can provision virtual machines from. Now there is another feature that we'll be doing a video on real soon called proximity placement groups, which are a way to reduce your network latency between your VM workloads. And if you are interested in that, click the subscribe button so that you don't miss that. This is not directly related to that feature, although you get a similar benefit because you're running your VMs on the same dedicated host, and then they will obviously be very close to each other. So you do get reduced network latency, but it is not the same thing, and we'll get into those details in that other video. Now, there are some high availability considerations to take into account. And then, of course, that gets into using availability zones and fault domains. Matter of fact, let's take a look over in the table of contents real quick here on availability and performance, and specifically availability. So this is where we get into all the high availability constructs in Azure, specifically availability zones and availability sets. Zones are where we have a certain amount of data centers within an Azure region. We take that, and depending on where they're located, we then break that into different zones. And there will be many zones in a region. Your particular subscription will have a zone assignment that we will call zone 1, zone 2, or zone 3. You don't have to particularly worry when any of these things exist in the real world. All you should be concerned about is that you put your stuff in zone 1 or zone 2, or to be zone redundant, you would have something in zone 1, zone 2, and zone 3. That depends on your architecture for your applications. But along with that, we also have availability sets. And availability sets are within the data centers themselves. We have racks of equipment. Each of those racks contain VM hosts and then also storage. And then we map that across racks, and we call those fault domains. So every rack is its own fault domain. And then we have the logical construct of update domains, which is going to spread across multiple racks. And both of these things are something you need to be aware of in figuring out your dedicated host build out and placement. So let's jump over to the Azure portal now and get started. So at the top here, we'll go to create a new resource, and I'll type in host group, and we'll select that, and we'll click create. But I'll create a new resource group for this, and I'll call it AA host group and hit OK. And then we need to give our host group a name, and we need to place it in a location like every other Azure resource. And now we have our choice of our availability zone and fault domains. Remember, those are the racks that we're going to span this across. So for the availability zone, our options are zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, or none. Now this is, again, dependent on the region that you select. If you select, for example, South Africa North, you can see that there are no availability zones present there. So I'll just choose East US and I'll put my stuff into zone 2. And then the number of fault domains that I would like would be 2, because I'm going to have 2 hosts and I want them on different racks. And we'll click next and then add the appropriate tags. So I'll use a tag for my cost center so I know who's paying for this, what environment I'm in, my application of the Azure Academy, and when my maintenance window is going to be, Thursday at 6 p.m. And then we'll hit the review and create button, and validation has passed so we can build our host group. Now, before I do, I want to show you the link here for the ARM template so you can capture this for future use. And you can see the same basic parameters here as well. So just be aware of that, and we'll hit create. And that should take just a moment. And then we'll be ready to provision our host. And our host group is now complete. So let's go to that resource. And just to give you the quick tour, you see across the top here, the resource group that it's in, how many hosts are provisioned, what the availability and fault domain counts are, the region and subscription that it's located in, as well as all of the tags. Now, like every Azure resource, we do have an activity log here, and you can see just one entry so far just being created. And we have access control, so you can do all of your role assignments, as well as look at all of your tags, add new ones, remove other tags, and then the properties pane where you'll find the resource ID for your host group. We also have resource locks, and I'm going to add a lock here. And this will be a delete lock, and that's going to protect this host group from being deleted, even by the owner. In order to do a delete, you will have to remove this lock first. And then we have the link for the export template, which again gives us the ARM code to be able to deploy this again in the future. Now, the one thing that isn't here is a button to provision new hosts, but we can search for that in the top, and we have a link here for hosts. So I'll click that and click to create a host. We'll want to put this in the same resource group, and then we need to give our host a name, and then select the appropriate region. Again, it should be the same region where our host group is. And now we have to select our hardware profile. That begins with selecting a VM family. Now we have here the DSV3, ESV3, and FSV3, and these are type ones, and this is a type two. Now, what does all of that stuff mean? The D, E, and F families are all series of VM SKUs, and the types refer to the different hardware generations. So this is a newer generation than these guys are. So I'm going to select the F series here, and then we have our number of fault domains, and I'll select 2 fault domains. Then we have the option to automatically replace a host on failure. Now, what this will do if we choose this to be enabled, looking back at the docs, is going to do some automation around the host lifecycle. And if you run into some issues with your underlying host, the host will first be under investigation when there's a problem, and will determine what the root cause is and if that requires action on our part. And then we will put the host into a deallocated state, assuming that you choose this feature to be enabled. And the VMs will move off of it to a host that is running all right until your services can be healed and restored. Otherwise, the VMs running on that host may fail if the host does. So this is something that I would recommend, but if this is a lab, perhaps you would not want this feature enabled. Then we come to the part where you can enable the Azure Hybrid Use benefit. And this feature, if you did not see it, is part of our cost saving measures video. You can go and check out the YouTube card up in the top corner for that. And basically, if you have software assurance on your enterprise agreement, then you can turn this on. And that way you won't be paying for the Windows or SQL licenses in Azure. And then we'll hit next and add our tags. And so we've added a cost center, again, so we know who's paying for it, our application, environment, maintenance window, and we've also added a business unit. That way we know which department is running this host. And we'll hit the review button here, and our validation has passed. So let's open up our ARM template, and I'm going to take this template and add it to my library, and I'll hit save for that so I can provision my second host really quickly. And then we'll hit the create button. And while that's provisioning, I'll go to my template library inside Azure, and I'll open my template for my new host and hit deploy. And then I just have to fill out the appropriate parameters, and now I can kick off that second deployment. We'll hit purchase, and both of those should be done in just a few moments. And now that our hosts are done, let's open one of these guys up and check it out. And it looks very similar to our host group. Across the top, we can see the host's ID as well as the host group it belongs to, the VM family, how many VMs are currently deployed, and the number of fault domains. And then we've got our activity log, access control, and tags like on all Azure resources. And then we have the instances, and these are the particular VMs that we have deployed, which we can do from here or from the regular VM screen, which I'll show you in a moment. And under the configuration tab, we've got the ability to turn on the Azure Hybrid Use benefit if you did not have that at the time that you provisioned, but you do have that at a later point. And then the properties, again, where you can find the resource ID, and then locks and exporting your template. Now, of course, as I said, we could deploy a VM from here, so we'll do that for one of our workloads. And it looks just like the deploying a VM screen always looks, so we'll give this a name. So we'll call this dedicated VM1, we'll put it in East US and availability zone number 2. And then we have to pick a VM size that is compatible with our host. And so I'll pick F2S_V2 and hit select. And then we do everything pretty much as usual. So I'll give it a name and a password. I'm not going to have any inbound ports, but I will enable the Azure Hybrid Use benefit. I'll set the VM for standard SSDs. We'll hit next for the network here. And I do want to change the network that we're using because I want to use a different address space. And since we're changing the address space, we also have to declare a subnet range, and then we'll hit OK. And I don't need a public IP or network security group for this VM. We'll hit next, and the management screen looks just like it always has. And there's the link to enable Azure Active Directory authentication. And if you missed our video on that, you can check that out in the YouTube card at the top. And we'll hit next for advanced. And then here we can select our host group. And then we've found two hosts that are here. I'll select host 1. And there's that link for proximity placement group. Again, subscribe if you want to see that video. So we'll hit next for our tags. And so we've set our cost center. Our environment will be dedicated host for the Azure Academy. And our business unit this time will be accounting. So we had our host, which was dedicated to IT. And now we're provisioning a workload for the accounting group as part of that host. And we'll hit next. And again, before we do the build, we'll look at the template. And in general, this is a normal VM build, but looking at the virtual machine resource, we can see that there is a host ID that is here, and that's telling us that we can build on a particular host that's in a particular host group. So if you wanted to use this on your existing VM templates, you can just add this one parameter, and I'll also show you how to do this on existing VMs as well. So we'll hit create. And that'll get underway. So let's look at an existing virtual machine. And these are all the VMs that I have. And we've got two here that are labeled as existing VM 1 and 2. And they're in a stopped and deallocated state, which is important because you cannot change a host setting if you are running. So I'll open one of these VMs. And under the configuration in the blade, you can see we've got our host and host group setting. Note that you cannot join a host. You must first join a host group. And now you can select the host, and I'll choose host number 2 and hit save. And I'll repeat that on the other virtual machine under configuration, host group, and then host. We'll save. And looking back at our host group resources, under host number 2, under our instances, we've got our two hosts now listed here. And note again that the virtual machine family that the VMs are a part of needs to match the VM family that the host is servicing. And if we just check back with our original host group, we can see both of our dedicated hosts are listed here. And if we click on our host link, that takes us to our dedicated host. And then we can see our instance count. We've got our dedicated VM that we have deployed. So I hope that you've enjoyed looking at Azure Dedicated Hosts, a way to create hardware isolation in the public cloud so I can have a physical server dedicated to my subscription to isolate myself from anyone else that's running in the cloud. And this will have real great application in high security environments, high regulatory environments, or just somewhere where you're concerned that you don't want someone else's stuff running on the same physical host as you are. So if you thought that this video was good, please give us a thumbs up and join us here at the Azure Academy by clicking on our subscribe button. And if you'd like to get an email when our videos come out, which is roughly once a week, then you can click on the email notification bell as well. And we're here just to help everyone learn all they can about Azure. So if you'd like a video to be created on a topic that we don't yet cover, please give me some comments down below and we'll be happy to do that. Thanks for joining us today, and we will see you in the next video. Happy learning.